Welcome to another video here from Green Ham Gaming. This video is for you guys, the now 100 subscribers, and for those of you who have been showing extensive support, consider this your official thank you. Let's make 2015 a great year, and lots of love to all of our fans out there from the guys here at Green Ham. Enjoy this video, and have a good night. First big steps for overclocking is making a cup of tea and learning some patience. Many a young overclocker has hurried into the process and found themselves in deep trouble down the track, so simply taking it slow is essential to any successful overclock. Step 2 is of course cooling. By increasing the clock speed, you are increasing the heat generated by your CPU. So you need to make sure that your cooling solution is more than adequate before pushing ahead with the overclock. Now apparently with this specific chip, you can get away with the stock cooler all the way up to about 4 GHz. But I wanted to push the chip much harder than that, so I went with the H100i liquid cooler from Corsair. And since I decided I was too good for reading the manual properly, installing the cooler took me a lot longer than it should have. But we got it in eventually. Alright, after a bit of a mess up with the thermal paste and a few other minor ups on the way, we've managed to get the H100i and the Pentium G3258 installed into our case here. The radiator's mounted up there, as you can see, and is pulling air from inside the case back out like that through this exhaust flap up here. We're just burn testing it right now to make sure that the CPU is actually being cooled, because what happened before was we turned it on, started a burn test, and within a matter of seconds the CPU temperature was at 90 degrees, which is, you know, not safe by any means for a CPU, so we knew there was a problem pretty much. I knew that something was wrong from that point, and looking when I actually took the cooler off, we found that there was no contact whatsoever. The cooler wasn't actually cooling the CPU at all, and CPU was just sitting there burning up. So we had to adjust the motherboard about four or five times. But we got it in there, and now things are looking fairly stable. So we'll begin the overclocking tomorrow. Step 4 is of course take it easy and run lots of tests and observe temperatures and stability very closely. As you slowly bump up the CPU clock, make sure to keep feeding your hungry CPU more juice. Now let's jump into the overclocking and see how hard we can push this young but courageous Pentium.
Good feeling.
And now the question you have all been waiting for. How much better does it perform in-game? Well, in Bioshock Infinite, not a huge performance difference is made from the overclock, as the stock Pentium pulled 22 frames per second at its worst and 72 at its best, while with the overclock we got a significant rise in minimum FPS, but the average is only slightly better than that of the stock speed and the i3. In Crysis 2, the Pentium really showed its potential, keeping up with the i3 at stock speeds and smashing it once overclocked. In CSGO, the stock Pentium was unimpressive to say the least, pulling 51 FPS at its worst and 122 at its best, but once overclocked, it absolutely smashed the i3, with a noticeably smoother average frame rate and a much higher 285 FPS at its best. In Far Cry 3, it was clear the hyper-threading and extra features in the i3 really helped it beat the Pentium. But considering the Pentium came very close and costs half as much, I think we'll let this one slide. But if older Valve games are your thing, the Pentium has your back, offering literally double the performance of the i3 in Gmod and Half-Life 2. If Minecraft is your game, you might want to invest in an i3 or i5, because as you can see here, Minecraft is very CPU bound and will do better with a few more cores. But these frame rates are still perfectly smooth, and it is clear it is worth overclocking the Pentium if you play Minecraft, as the average doubles. Though if you like older games like Killing Floor, the Pentium's high clock will allow it to smash the competition, offering over double the performance of the i3 when overclocked. I have actually gained a huge respect for Intel for making this version of the Pentium. Take this from a hardcore AMD guy, this is one of the few chips that I would turn Intel for. This chip is like the tortoise and the hare. Looking at it, you assume it is low-end, slow, and for people who just check their emails and look at their family photos, but once overclocked, it can keep up with processors double its price. But that's the thing. Once upon a time, having a Pentium in your computer was equivalent to having an i7. Some games even said, "Do you want your graphics at 386, 486, or Pentium speed?" as if the Pentium name was reserved for those who only had the best of gaming rigs. Well, I'm proud to say that Intel has made the Pentium name cool again with this chip. For the first time in 10 years, I can say that I am a proud Pentium owner. I hope that this is the first chip in a series that will make the Pentium a cool brand once again and represent the power that it used to be. This Pentium is an average chip when kept stock, but once overclocked it can shred an i3 and even take on an i5 for half the price. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you have any questions or suggestions for future videos, pop them down below and I'll try to help as best I can. Otherwise, if you like this kind of goofy computer content, do like and subscribe and enjoy the rest of your evening. Still forever a hardcore AMD guy. But what you showed me today, Intel, with this Pentium G3258 for $99, Intel, you have done very well.